How does that all work? So we're going to revisit Archimedes' principle very briefly here, and we're going to think about the restoring force. Okay, so here is a volume in a fluid, all right? So this is embedded inside the fluid, and I've made it look like a cylinder here. And so what are the pressure forces on that cylinder to start with? Well, we know that in this fluid, pressure will be increasing downwards, right? That's just hydrostatic relation. Okay. So we know the pressure here, I've called it P minus, it'll be less than the pressure down here, just called it P plus, right? And the pressure on this upper surface, this disk here, is P minus times the area of the disk. That's the force. Pressure times surface area is force, okay? Pressure is force per unit area. And that is pushing downwards, because pressure always pushes in on things, right? And at the bottom, it's pushing upwards. And there's a slight imbalance between the top and the bottom, because the pressure is greater at the bottom. So the net result of these two forces is an upward force. On the sides, you have the pressure times this length times the circumference, but it cancels out, because what's pushing that way is the same thing pushing this way. At every level, the pressure is the same horizontally. So the imbalance in force is in the vertical, okay? And you have slightly more up push than you have down push from the pressure field. And so the net force will be upwards, it will be P plus times A minus P minus times A. So P plus minus P minus times A, that's the net upward force, and that is balanced by the net downward force, which is the weight of whatever's in that volume, right? Which is the density times this area times this length times gravity, okay? So at equilibrium, let's assume that there's no net force on this, so this adds up to zero. That would be the case if this volume just contained water, which is the same water as everything else around it, okay? Then obviously it would be in equilibrium. And so this rho here would just be the density of the water, right? And then you'd have an equality between this pressure difference and rho times L times G. And you can write then, if L is the interval of depth, delta Z, then you can write delta P divided by delta Z is equal to minus rho G, right? So delta P, the difference in pressure going upwards, which is negative, delta Z, the vertical change in height. So it'll be minus rho times G. That is the hydrostatic equation, right? Now what happens if inside this volume there is something other than the same water which is outside the volume, right? Something with a different density. Well, there'll be a net imbalance here, because this rho will be either bigger or smaller. If the rho is smaller, then there'll be an upward force. It'll float upwards. If the rho is bigger, gravity will win. It'll go downwards. And so, you know, this is how Archimedes figured out the density of gold, because the king of Greece wanted to know if his crown was made out of pure gold or somebody was cheating him by giving him something impure. And Archimedes thought about it for a while, and he decided, well, the way to do it is to put the crown in the water. This thought came to him in the bath, because he got into the bath and he realized that he was displacing water. And so he was so excited he ran around the streets naked saying Eureka. So this is a famous story. The net upward force here, right, is always the same. It doesn't matter what's in that volume. It could be a crown, it could be the same water, could be water of a slightly different density, it doesn't matter. The pressure pushes in on it, and the difference in pressure is the same. It just pushes in on that volume. And the net upward force obviously is the same as the weight of water if it's the same kind of water. So the weight of the water that is displaced. That is Archimedes' principle. The buoyancy force is equal to the weight of the fluid that has been displaced, right? When you talk about the Poussée d'Archimède as some sort of force, all you're talking about is the pressure gradient force, okay? And the difference between that and the weight, right? So that is just a recap on stuff that you learnt at school, probably. And we're going to apply that now to a situation where you have imbalance. Let's say we have a parcel of water, And now, not only is pressure changing with depth, but so is the density, right? So we have a stratified fluid. And so this parcel of water is, let's say that we move it to another level. It will now, assuming it doesn't change its density as it moves, which is a pretty good assumption, because it takes a while to change the density of something. It's diffusion, okay? Diffusion is a slow process. So if this thing moves suddenly to another level, it's not going to suddenly have the same density as the water around it. It's going to keep the same density, right? So if you move it up, well, if it's stably stratified, then that will mean that, well, if the density is, the environmental density is more here than it is here, move this up, it's going to be heavier than its surrounding. It's going to want to sink back down again, okay? On the other hand, its pressure will immediately equilibrate to its surrounding pressure, okay? It doesn't conserve its pressure as it moves up. Pressure will equilibrate at the speed of sound, okay? Sound waves will equilibrate the pressure field, right? It's going to change its pressure as it goes up to be the same as the surrounding pressure, but it's going to keep its density from its original position. What does that look like in terms of the vertical momentum equation for this parcel, right? Well, the force imbalance will give us the vertical acceleration, okay? So here's the vertical acceleration multiplied by the density, so that should give us the force per unit mass, right? So this is dw by dt. W is the vertical velocity, right? So rho times dw by dt, which is the parcel density, rho p, times d squared zp by dt squared, where zp is the position of the parcel, and that will be equal to the net imbalance of force per unit mass, which is minus the vertical pressure gradient minus rho p times g, right? So that's our force imbalance. If it's hydrostatic, then that is zero, okay? Because we're in balance. But if there's a slight imbalance because of the movement of this parcel, that will not be zero, right? However, the environment around the parcel will be in hydrostatic balance. So this is true for the environment around the parcel. Zero is equal to dp by dz, the same dp by dz, minus rho env times g, where that's the environmental density, right? So you can combine these two equations, and you get an equation for the vertical acceleration in terms of the density difference between the parcel and its surroundings. And so you can say that the vertical acceleration is this factor times g. So that vertical acceleration depends on g, but it's also multiplied by delta rho over rho, where that delta rho is the difference between the parcel and its surroundings. It could be positive or negative. And this is called the reduced gravity. It's some small factor times g. If we argue that the parcel conserves its density during the displacement, which we just said, right, then the vertical variation of density as the parcel moves is going to be the same as the difference between the parcel and its environment, right? That's just logical, which means that rho p minus rho environment divided by zp is just the environmental vertical density gradient. So we can plug that back into the equation, and we get an equation for the vertical acceleration of the parcel, d squared zp by dt squared, is equal to now something which is entirely in terms of the environment, g over rho d rho by dz, times the position of the parcel. So that's a kind of harmonic motion equation. And this g over rho d rho by dz, that is minus n squared, where n is called the Brunt-Weissler frequency. So n is an oscillation frequency. That's a harmonic motion equation. You just have d squared by dt squared equals minus a constant times z. So if that n squared is positive, then you'll have oscillations, right? The solution of this equation is that the position of the parcel is a sine and cosine functions of n times t, right? So n is the oscillation frequency. We're oscillating with a frequency n. Imagine if the fluid had a greater density above and a lesser density below, right? What would happen then? N squared would be negative, which means that n is imaginary, and the solutions to this equation are not trigonometric, they are exponential, and you'll have exponentially growing solutions with time, right? So if you've got dense water overlying less dense water, you're going to have something which very quickly reaches large amplitude, because you have a big overturning of the fluid, and that is a statically unstable fluid.